Michael Jackson is considered today as one of pop music's most successful and, as a result, richest artists of all time. The incredible wealth he amassed over the years attracted countless headlines, as well as his later financial blows. However, much misinformation has been put out over the years, largely due to overzealous rumors and sensationalized tabloid fodder. How did he exactly make his considerable fortune? Was Michael Jackson pop's first billionaire? And did the king of pop end up dying completely broke? In this series of videos, we hope to, in some estimation, uncover the numbers behind Michael Jackson's complex finances, from his royalty checks to numerous business dealings, endorsement payouts, and outlandish expenses, revealing the truth behind Michael Jackson's colossal bank account. Here's the detail. When Michael and his brothers first hit the pop music scene in 1969 as the Jackson 5, they debuted with a string of number one hits that broke records, pushing the Beatles out the charts. Within a year, the singles I Want You Back, ABC, The Love You Save, and I'll Be There sold over 3 million units each. Their debut album also raked in the cash, with Diana Ross Presents The Jackson 5 selling over 500,000 copies by the end of 1970. Their newfound chart success meant that the Jackson 5 were also performing to sellout audiences around the U.S., with their first six-show tour grossing over $500,000, $3.8 million in today's dollars. However, the Motown-founded group had their record label take a hefty proportion of the revenue earned from record sales, leaving them with the 2.8% royalty rate as per their contract. In their first 3 years, the Jackson 5 sold an incredible 33 million singles and 8 million albums, giving the group an estimated cut of $1.8 million to $2.7 million, $13.2 million to $19.7 million when adjusted for inflation. In addition, the brothers toured almost continuously throughout this period, embarking on no less than 3 domestic tours as well as one in Europe, performing over 119 shows and grossing approximately $5.9 million, $43.1 million when adjusted for inflation, giving them a cut of between $2.9 million to $4.1 million, $21.2 million to $30 million when adjusted for inflation. If you include merchandise and other income streams, by the end of 1972, the Jackson 5 as an entity earned them a total of $5.7 million to $8.6 million. Or $41.7 million to $62.9 million today. Michael Jackson openly spoke about receiving $200,000 royalty checks in the mail as a kid, in which he would cash in, take a couple of dollars out to buy some candy, and leave the rest in the bank. However, during this period, young Michael didn't have access to any personal wealth of his own, as his earnings were managed by his father and absorbed into the Jackson family finances. When the Jacksons announced they were leaving their record label in 1975, industry commentators estimated that the group were contributing as much as a third of Motown's yearly revenue of $45 million, $255.7 million today. Instead, the family's patriarch secured a lucrative contract to have the group sign with Epic Records, a subsidiary of CBS, who agreed to give them more creative control over their musical output and offered a much higher royalty rate of 20% per record. Although the brothers went on to sell millions as the Jacksons, Michael was never given the opportunity to acquire his own personal wealth until he developed an independent career as an adult. His first solo record with CBS, Off the Wall, was off the bat a huge success, selling over 5 million copies domestically in its first year, becoming the best-selling record of 1980 and the highest-selling album by a black artist up until that point. His solo royalty rate was similarly as favorable as what was offered to poach the brothers from Motown, which meant Michael the artist was in a unique position, amassing a considerable fortune from just one record. Earning $1.10 to $1.50 per album sold, by the end of 1982, Michael Jackson received a figure of approximately $9.4 to $12.8 million, or $29.8 million to $40.5 million when adjusted for inflation. Meanwhile, his father, Joseph, was having financial issues after several bad business dealings and was reportedly looking to sell the family's Los Angeles home. In response to this crisis, Michael offered to purchase the house from them, gifting a 50% stake in the property to his mother, The singer then made grand plans with his newfound wealth to effectively knock down the old mid-century structure and rebuild a fairy tale mansion in French chateau style. Its centerpiece became a 5-bedroom, 7-bathroom, 10,000 square foot residence. The property also included a state-of-the-art home studio and 3 small stores that resembled a candy store, a puppet shop, and an ice cream shop. Additions to the property also included a 6-foot Snow White and the Seven Dwarves diorama, a movie theater, games room, a small zoo, manicured gardens, and a koi pond. While Michael's dream home was being constructed, his attorney, John Branca, secured him the highest royalty rate ever achieved in the music industry up until that point. With his contract up for negotiation and with a very promising career ahead, having achieved sky-high record sales with Off the Wall, he was in prime position to secure a very lucrative deal for his next LP. With approximately $2, or $5.68 today, going in his pocket for each album sold, Michael Jackson released his 1982 juggernaut Thriller. Over the course of 1983, Michael Jackson's bank accounts were flooded with cash as the royalty checks kept coming in. Thriller spent a record 37 weeks at number 1 on the Billboard 200 and at its peak was selling 1 million units a week. The record later became the best-selling album in the United States in 1983 and 1984, making it the first album to be the best-selling for 2 years. And of course, was awarded the best-selling album of all time in February 1984. From Thriller sales alone, by the spring of 1984, Michael Jackson had quickly amassed an incredible fortune of $50 million, or $147 million when adjusted for inflation. At this time, Michael leveraged his incredible fortune to push his career into new heights, as demonstrated when his record company refused to fund the production for his Thriller music video. Jackson paid for it himself and offset the additional cost of $500,000, or $1.4 million today, by having a production crew document its creation for the making of Michael Jackson's Thriller home video. During the infancy of home VCR systems, the documentary became the best-selling video cassette at the time, selling well over 50,000 copies within 6 months of its release, making the now global superstar in excess of $2 million, or $5.9 million today. 1984 would also be significant as Michael Jackson embarked on the then highest grossing tour of all time, the Victory Tour, grossing $75 million, or $220.6 million today. Him and his brothers also secured an endorsement deal with Pepsi Cola worth $5 million, or $14.7 million today. However, its bloated production costs, high ticket price, and dodgy payment processing tactics caused a widespread public backlash and forced Michael to give up his portion of profits from the tour in order to stem the ongoing PR crisis, giving the charity an estimated $5 million, or $14.7 million when adjusted for inflation. Michael also gave the settlement he received from Pepsi for the burns he suffered while filming to the hospital that treated him, amounting to $1.5 million, or $4.4 million today. Although Michael's focus was more on giving his money away, the press and promotional benefits of the Victory Tour led the superstar's Thriller record to surpass sales of 40 million units by 1985, netting Michael additional royalty payments of $30 million, or $85.2 million when adjusted for inflation. Swamped with cash and with an estimated net worth of $100 million, or $284 million today, Michael was keen to make large-scale investments with his considerable newfound wealth, the largest being his purchase of the ATV music catalog in the summer of 1985 for a whopping $47.5 million, or the equivalent of $135 million today. Jackson went moonwalker to mogul and instantly the most powerful individual in all of music publishing. On top of income he already received for his own work, Michael Jackson would now take 50% of all royalty payments for when these songs were played, performed, or used for other activities like licensing for a film or television commercial. Before his purchase of the catalog, ATV was grossing approximately $15 million per annum, $44.3 million when adjusted for inflation, with half its revenue tied to Beatles music. In the years that followed, Jackson would increase profits through lucrative yet controversial licensing deals, as well as compilation album and documentary releases. upping his own personal income, but also adding value to the asset he invested in. In preparation for the release of his next record and first solo tour, Michael Jackson signed a new 3-year advertising contract with Pepsi-Cola that was the largest of its kind, worth somewhere between $5 million and $15 million, or $13.9 million and $41.8 million today. In return, Jackson would appear in no less than 4 commercials which were to be shown in the United States and abroad, and also contribute 2 pieces of original music and perform 1 song from an upcoming album. While busy recording, in 1986 and 1987, Michael Jackson reportedly earned an additional $80 million, or $215.3 million today, largely from royalty payments, despite it being almost 5 years since his last record was released. As soon as his next album, Bad, was released in 1987, Michael embarked on a gigantic worldwide tour. The tour and his music videos helped promote his latest release, pushing it and its singles to the top of the charts. One very expensive investment Jackson personally made towards the project was the production costs for his full-length musical feature film, Moonwalker. Costing in excess of $30 million, $80.7 million today, the very ambitious film was released theatrically in Europe and South America, but Warner Brothers canceled plans for a Christmas 1988 theatrical release in the United States. Moonwalker was instead released on home video, and within a year, sold more than 800,000 copies in the United States, reportedly grossing $67 million, $165.2 million, when adjusted for inflation. However, for Michael Jackson, the real moneymakers during this period came in the form of album sales and touring. In 1988, Forbes magazine estimated that Jackson was the highest-paid entertainer of the year, earning a colossal $60 million, $155 million today, during a 12-month period in 1987 to 1988. Stating that, quote, "Rock stars make their money in up to 6 basic ways. There are royalties from songwriting, recording, videos, and souvenirs. There is live performance, and there is sponsorship. And he has been milking all 6. Since its release a year prior, Bad had sold between 12 to 15 million copies and earned him approximately $30 million, $77.5 million when adjusted for inflation. Forbes commenting that although his sales are still high, the cost of producing a Michael Jackson album had also increased. Quote, "He would have to repay the costs of recording it advanced by CBS because he spent so much time in the studio. The costs will have been astronomical, but he should be able to afford it." They also note that sales of his top-selling autobiography, Moonwalk, that sold 120,000 copies in Britain alone, as well as selling tabloid newspapers and serial rights, just one admitting to pay $520,000, meant Jackson raked in millions for the book and contributed to his sky-high earnings during this period. However, Michael Jackson also worked hard for the rest of his millions, performing night after night on his Bad World Tour. Financially, concerts used to be so expensive to produce, they were largely just a promotional tool, with artists making money only out of t-shirt and other souvenir sales, all shamelessly overpriced and yielding 25% to the artist. Michael Jackson concerts, however, made the artist a considerable living. Forbes noting that just 14 shows in Britain and Ireland grossed $26.9 million, $69.5 million today. Upon the tour's completion in early 1989, the Bad World Tour grossed a total of $125 million, $308.2 million today, and was the highest-grossing solo tour of the 1980s. As a result, in 1989, Forbes magazine estimated Michael Jackson's earning for the year at $65 million, or $160.2 million when adjusted for inflation, raking in $40 million, $98.6 million today, from his recent worldwide tour, this making him the second time in a row the world's highest paid entertainer. However, it wasn't all work and no play for Michael as he developed a taste for the finer things, spending handsomely on his now lavish lifestyle. His biggest expense was his Santa Barbara residence, Neverland Valley Ranch, which he purchased in 1988 for $19.5 million, $50.4 million today. Over the years to come, Jackson spent approximately $35 million, $90.4 million today, transforming the expansive compound into his own paradise, constructing a full-scale movie theater, an amusement park, exotic zoo, bird and reptile house. He also filled his home with art antiques, arcade games, and anything else he desired. Just the yearly running and staffing costs of Neverland was estimated to be $3 million, $7.8 million today, an expense well worth it for the global pop icon. Even with Michael Jackson maintaining a low profile at the dawn of the 1990s, he still appeared on the list of top-earning entertainers in 1990. With an annual income of $35 million, $81.9 million when adjusted for inflation. The reclusive star's wealth grew largely due to royalties collected for his music, his ATV catalog's earnings, and other business ventures, including his best-selling video game collaboration with Sega, Moonwalker. In 1991, Michael Jackson signed an unprecedented deal with Sony Music Entertainment. Quote, "We're married to him now," said Sony president Michael P. Schwolnoff. As instead of signing with Sony as simply a recording artist, Jackson negotiated a much more intertwined partnership that had the potential to spawn sales of over $1 billion. Collaborating with Sony Music, Columbia Pictures, and Sony Electronic Publishing, the entertainer was expected to not only record 6 studio albums, but to have his hand in a range of endeavors including films, television, and video gaming. Upon signing the 360-degree contract, Sony agreed to pay Michael Jackson a series of advances totaling $50 million, $112.2 million in dollars today. However, industry spectators questioned the move. Quote, "Since Sony spent $2 billion on acquiring CBS, it has continued a corporate shopping spree for entertainment properties. Many senior figures in the music and film business seriously questioned the wisdom that motivated Sony to re-sign Jackson, as they see it, regardless of cost." After 2 years raking up expensive studio time, giant expectations for Sony to invest tens of millions in marketing and at least $20 million in music videos to promote Jackson's next LP, Sony was banking on Michael's album sales remaining sky high. With the release of 1991's Dangerous, Michael put everything into promoting the record, including starring in several high-profile music videos, wowing audiences with award show performances, and a Super Bowl halftime show, agreeing to his first sit-down interview in 14 years, and embarked on another worldwide tour. Even though he vowed to never tour again, Jackson was convinced to go on the road by his record label, but this time it wasn't to line his own pockets, but to benefit his newly found charity, Heal the World, with a goal to raise profits of $100 million by the end of 1993, $211.5 million when adjusted for inflation. Pepsi came in again to sponsor the tour, paying the pop icon undisclosed millions for his endorsement and contributing $100,000, $217,000 today, towards Michael's new foundation. Performing night after night around the world, Dangerous sales increased abroad at a faster pace when compared to domestically, and within 2 years of its release, the LP had sold over 20 million copies. In addition, Jackson had negotiated an even more favorable royalty rate that netted him approximately 25% of an album's retail price, a rate that translated to $2.50, or $5.29 today. Therefore, by 1993, he had made at least $40 million from the release of Dangerous, the first album released under his new contract. Aside from his own album sales, Michael Jackson successfully increased profits from his ATV music catalog, and by 1993, it was said to be earning him annually an additional $26 million, or $55 million in dollars today. In 1993, Forbes magazine estimated Michael Jackson's net worth to be at around $150 million, or $317.3 million when adjusted for inflation. He was the king of pop, a world-class performer and highly profitable music artist who had leveraged his wealth to acquire considerable assets without the need to take on any extra debts. Although Jackson was a huge earner, he was equally a big spender, giving generously to charities, buying lavish gifts, and making ostentatious purchases. But unfortunately, not all his impressive income was spent on his every whim and desire. Being one of the richest and most famous people in the world meant a large target was placed on his back, whether by the vicious mainstream press or those looking to line their pockets with his fortune by any means possible. Michael soon had a team of lawyers busy in court with cases made against him for numerous reasons, whether alleged broken contracts, unpaid staff members, accusations he plagiarized music, and even unfounded baby mama drama. None of these character assassinations seemed to impact the empire Michael had built. Not until the summer of 1993, when one accusation would ignite a series of events that would see his financial good fortune take a detrimental turn for the worse.
Boy, a against top icon Michael Jackson.
Like a criminal. Jackson's
crime in Los Angeles.
By the summer of 1993, the world-class entertainer was estimated by Forbes magazine to be worth more than $150 million, or $317.3 million when adjusted for inflation, with earnings from the last year amounting to $42 million, or $91 million today. However, when news broke of child molestation allegations, just as Jackson was beginning the second leg of his Dangerous World tour, his financial good fortune began to take a turn. Relentless hounding by the world press as the salacious story developed left Michael in a spiraling personal and public image nightmare. This scandal eventually resulting in the cancellation of the rest of the Dangerous World tour due to Michael Jackson's deteriorating health and desperate need for treatment for a dependency on prescription drugs. The personal nightmare also had its financial ramifications. Soon after Jackson's announcement, Pepsi made their own statement, cutting ties with the superstar after 10 years of multi-million dollar endorsement deals. PepsiCo spokesman Gary Hemphill said that the only agreement they had with Jackson was to sponsor this particular international tour. Quote, "The cancellation really effectively cancels our relationship with Michael right now," Hemphill commented. Quote, "We just hope he is able to resolve his problems." Although after this decision, Pepsi never worked with Michael Jackson again. Aside from corporate sponsors, canceling the tour incited its promoters to take legal action against the performer in the tune of $20 million, $42.3 million today. Arguing that an addiction to drugs is not a good enough reason for those invested to lose out, claiming Michael Jackson was dependent on drugs well before the tour contract was negotiated and signed. The lawsuit claimed breach of contract, fraud, fraudulent concealment, negligent misrepresentation, and conspiracy to defraud. Quote, "My client has given Mr. Jackson more than $2 million in advances, $900,000 alone for the days he canceled," the case's lawyer said. In addition to advance money for private jets, stadium rental, and setup personnel, although no more was reported on this case, Michael likely dealt with the matter out of court, incurring the cost of settling and hefty legal bills in the process. The tour's cancellation also had many questioning whether Michael Jackson's ultimate goal was in jeopardy, to raise an incredible $100 million, $211.5 million when adjusted for inflation, for his Heal the World Foundation. The organization did indeed build playgrounds, provided immunizations, and funded scores of children's causes around the world. It helped pay for a Hungarian boy's life-saving liver transplant and co-sponsored an airlift of more than 46 tons of relief supplies to war-torn Bosnia-Herzegovina in 1992. Although it never reached the pop star's lofty fundraising goal, the foundation reportedly doled out about $4 million, or $8 million today, said its former director, Richard Fowler. However, Jackson effectively abandoned the foundation by the mid-90s and never made any more serious attempts to fundraise for his charity past this point. Aside from the loss of earnings Michael Jackson suffered as a result of the child molestation claims, their legal ramifications also took a significant hit on his finances, the most publicized expense being the $23 million, or $47.4 million when adjusted for inflation, settlement Jackson agreed as part of the civil lawsuit, $5 million, or $10.3 million today, of which was to pay their lawyers' fees, giving us an insight that if the accusers incurred legal costs amounting several million dollars, you could only imagine how much Michael Jackson was paying for legal representation. In fact, he was advised to settle the case, in part because it was the cheaper option when compared to going to court and the additional colossal costs that would occur. However, the multi-million dollar payout didn't curb Michael's sky-high legal expenses. It actually encouraged countless others to come out of the woodwork and push Jackson for lottery-level settlements of their own. The landslide of cases kept the superstar's world-class legal team busy for years to come. With Jackson now point-blank refusing to pay off those with baseless claims looking to extort money from him. Therefore, the only parties to win were the lawyers involved. In 1994, Forbes magazine reported that in the previous year, Michael Jackson had made $38 million, or $78.4 million today. An incredible amount of money, but due to the astronomical expenses he incurred as a result of the 1993 allegations, this meant that Michael was for the very first time in financial hot water and needed to release some extra cash. Hence, the King of Pop agreed to sign a 5-year contract with EMI Music to manage his music publishing company, ATV Music, in exchange for an advance of $70 million, or $148 million today, against revenue that EMI expected to generate. In addition, EMI agreed to enter into partnership with Jackson and provide him with financing to acquire other music catalogs. In 1995, Michael would leverage his ATV music catalog once again when Sony offered Jackson $110 million, or $200.6 million today, for a 50% stake in an ATV and Sony Music Publishing joint venture. Jackson essentially sold half of his ownership of the Beatles and other songs for a large profit, Sony ATV becoming the second largest music publisher in the world worth $500 million, the equivalent of $1 billion today. Administrative expertise was provided by Sony, and Jackson was a company director and attended board meetings regularly. As each party in the arrangement held the power of a veto, Michael still remained in control as both sides would have to agree on a decision before it could be made. As a result of the King of Pop's savvy business arrangements, they helped his yearly income, with Forbes magazine reporting in 1996 that the global superstar had earned the previous year approximately $67 million, or $130.5 million today, and the year after, $90 million, $171.4 million today. Aside from publishing, Michael Jackson was keen to get his music career back on track and release another top-selling record, but yet again, the significant profits he made from selling albums were eaten up by his King of Pop demands. Delay after delay, hiring out expensive studio spaces, a record for Michael Jackson demanded the most elaborate of marketing strategies. Predicting sales worth $500 million, much of the $40 million, or $80 million today, spent to promote his latest release, the double album epic History, came from the artist. Jackson himself invested $5 million, or $10 million today, producing a controversial 4-minute album teaser for the project, and spent $7 million, or $14 million today, creating the most expensive music video in all time for its lead single Scream. Within the first year of its release, History reportedly sold over 11 million copies. Impressive by the standards of most pop stars, but well below previous sales by one of the best-selling pop singers of all time. And for the first time ever, Michael Jackson actually lost money releasing new music. This may be why, during a live internet chat, MJ said of History, quote, "This might be my last album I ever do. I will always create music, but I'm not sure if I'll create another album." However, Jackson knew he could earn the big bucks not just from record sales. Accepting an offer of $17 million, or $33.1 million when adjusted for inflation, Michael Jackson agreed to perform to 60,000 guests at the Sultan of Brunei's 50th birthday celebrations in July of 1996. Mere months later, he embarked on the History World Tour. Performing 82 shows over 13 months, History became his highest-grossing tour ever, raking in $165 million. Or $314.3 million today. They were some of the most expensive shows ever staged, but during the tour, just two Sydney stages reaped almost $7 million in ticket sales alone, with merchandising raising another $1 million. It hasn't been reported what cut Michael Jackson took from the world tour, but Forbes estimated in 1997 that the global superstar had earned the year before $55 million, or $104.7 million today. From this period onwards, Michael Jackson fell off the top earning lists as press outlets began to report on his spiraling finances and mounting debts. His spending became increasingly outrageous, which included the $15 million, or $28.5 million today, he coughed up to produce his Ghosts short film. The video epic included elaborate sets, costumes, and cutting-edge special effects, and was released in order to promote what would become his lowest-selling album in decades, 1997's Blood on the Dance Floor. The latter part of the 1990s also characterized by announcements of grand, but ultimately fruitless, business dealings. It was clear that as his musical star faded, he desperately tried to invest in new sources of income. However, several of these ventures went disastrously wrong. Pouring millions into an internet venture called HollywoodTicket.com, the website was meant to offer exclusive backstage concert packages for fans with money to burn. Instead, it crashed and burned itself, and in 2001, its former partners sued Jackson for $25 million, or $42 million today, for what they claim were unpaid fees. Jackson also invested $11 million, or $18.7 million today, into a partnership with his company, Neverland Entertainment and MDP Worldwide Entertainment, to set up a new film production studio which failed to launch. Similarly, Michael Jackson invested heavily in his company Kingdom Entertainment, which hoped to build and manage family-friendly theme parks, hotels, and other attractions around the world. The venture took a large stake in Landmark Entertainment, a Californian company specializing in the design of theme park rides, and made headlines scouting locations in Detroit, Michigan, and the country of Poland, to name just a few. However, yet again, the ambitious plans never came into fruition. At the same time, the singer continued to spend as if he were still topping the charts like back in the 1980s. His Neverland Ranch annual running costs was said to be costing more than $7 million, or $11.8 million today. Michael's financial salvation could have come in the form of his 2001 studio album, Invincible. But with the record's production costing $40 million, or $69 million in today's dollars, was said to be the most expensive album ever made and failed to cover its costs. In 2003, Forbes magazine estimated that Michael Jackson had accumulated debts of over $200 million, or $332 million today, but had a net worth of $350 million, or $581 million today. According to a 2002 suit filed in the Californian Superior Court by Union Finance Investment Corp, seeking unpaid fees and expenses amounting to $12 million, or $20.4 million today, Jackson's borrowing had gotten out of control. 1998 documents showed loans totaling $90 million from Bank of America were nearly exhausted. Jackson later sought additional capital, and by 2000, Jackson had taken out loans totaling $270 million, or $480 million today. Some of the debt was secured using Sony ATV as collateral. Other loans were backed by Neverland and MyJack, a separate music publishing firm comprising of MJ's own music. Quote, "For whatever reason, Michael Jackson is not paying his debts," said Pierce O'Donnell, a leading entertainment finance lawyer. Quote, "He has little or no means of income. He lives off a line of credit." Brett Pulley, who covered Jackson's fortunes for Forbes, said there was, quote, "plenty of anecdotal evidence that Jackson's spending is way out of control." Although his superstar lifestyle was often cited as the main culprit for Jackson's money woes, courthouse dramas that continually followed him also claimed a considerable chunk of his income. However, certain legal bills and court-enforced payouts could have been avoided, including the $1.7 million, or $2.9 million today, awarded to Sotheby's Auction House for paintings Jackson bought, then decided he didn't want, and $5.3 million, or $9 million today, that went to a German concert promoter in a breach of contract suit. Quote, "Michael Jackson has for years been beset by lawsuits," Pulley noted. Quote, "What we see now is his inclination to get out there and fight those suits, which speaks to the idea that the cash isn't there to make things go away." However, publicly, the King of Pop kept up with his mega-rich image, coyly suggesting to interviewer Martin Bashir in the 2003 documentary Living with Michael Jackson that he was worth somewhere around $1 billion. When this film was broadcast on ABC in 2003, it caused major controversy for the artist and eventually led to him being accused of a second round of child abuse allegations, although this time Michael Jackson was determined to fight for his innocence in the courts. After a grueling and lengthy legal battle, Jackson came out of the whole ordeal victorious, but his health and bank balance were left in tatters as a result. Michael Jackson was spending like a billionaire on a millionaire's budget, with reports claiming that the superstar was on the brink of financial collapse. John DeRosso Bryan, a forensic accountant who testified during the pop star's trial, said Jackson spent up to $30 million, or $47 million today, a year more than he earned. Reportedly, the singer dropped $6 million, or $9.4 million today, on one shopping spree in Las Vegas, and the prosecution said in closing arguments he withdraws $1 million, or $1.6 million today, in cash at a time, and pays at least $4 million, or $6.3 million today, in legal bills most years. Legal analysts estimated that Michael Jackson invested up to $10 million, or $15.7 million today, on his legal team for the child abuse trial alone. Bank of America came down hard on Jackson, almost forcing him into bankruptcy proceedings after he fell short of a scheduled payment by about $300,000 for his $270 million, or $423 million today, worth of loans. However, after mounting pressure, Bank of America walked away from the situation, the bank notifying Jackson via fax that they were selling the loan package to Fortress Investment LLC to manage. An obvious solution to mounting debts when you have significant assets is to sell some of them to lower your liabilities. However, quote, "he does not want to sell his publishing, so his alternative is to restructure those debts. If able to restructure under favorable terms where the revenues of those assets can service the interest payments, he can handle it. If he can't restructure, he might have to sell a percentage of his publishing," said Forbes editor Brett Pulley. However, Michael Jackson chose not to face reality, so no major financial restructuring took place, and the global icon didn't curb his spending neither. In fact, due to interest payments outstripping his income, his colossal debts were only increasing. Jackson spent his final years living off the generosity of incredibly wealthy individuals he surrounded himself, particularly while living in the Middle East, staying in their hotels, using their luxury cars, and accepting any monetary gifts they might offer, including Brunei's Prince Azim, who in 2007 offered the King of Pop $10 million, or $14.7 million today, just to show up at his 25th birthday party in London. However, this behavior also got Jackson in some legal hot water when the King of Bahrain's son sued the pop star for $7 million, or $10.3 million today. Sheikh Abdullah bin Hamad Al Khalifa filed a breach of contract case, claiming Michael took $7 million as an advance on an album and an autobiography that he never produced. However, Jackson claimed the money was a gift. Al Khalifa also claimed that he paid the superstar $35,000, or $52,000 today, to go towards paying the utility costs at Neverland and another $2.2 million, or $3.2 million today, to cover some of his legal bills from the 2005 child molestation trial. Al Khalifa said he believed the money would be repaid once Jackson's career had recovered. Our last in-depth look at Michael's spiraling finances was revealed as part of court proceedings in 2007. In the documents, forensic accountants claimed Michael Jackson had total assets worth $567.6 million, or $836.8 million today. However, the five-page report also said Jackson now had debts of $331 million, or $488 million today, leaving him with a net worth of $236.6 million, or $348.8 million today. They put a net value on Jackson's 50% stake in the Sony ATV Music Publishing catalog, his most prized asset, at $390.6 million, or $575.9 million today, and claimed the singer had just $668,215 in cash. Michael Jackson's last attempt at turning a new leaf in his finances and resurrecting his legendary career came in 2009. Drowning in debt, now reportedly at $400 million, or $570 million today, the world-class performer fell back on what he knew he could make serious cash on: live performance. Therefore, he agreed to a new 50-date concert series. This is it at London's O2 Arena. The shows were reportedly going to earn Michael at least $50 million, or $71 million today, but industry insiders said this could be just the beginning. AEG, the organizers of the concerts, originally proposed a 3-year tour starting in Europe, then traveling to Asia, and finally returning to the United States. Although at that point, Jackson only committed to the O2 engagement. The demand was there for global concert ticket sales exceeding $450 million, or $641 million today. Quote, "You were talking about a guy who could make $500 million a year if he puts his mind to it," Tom Barak, a Californian financier, commented. Quote, "There are very few individual artists who are multi-billion dollar businesses, and he is one." According to its contract with the entertainer, AEG advanced Jackson close to $30 million, or $42.7 million today, which included a $15 million line of credit, a $5 million advance, $7.5 million to cover production costs, and rent for a Holmby Hills mansion. But with his Neverland ranch on the brink of foreclosure, his belongings narrowly stopped from being auctioned, and still with endless multi-million dollar legal dramas looming, the King of Pop tragically passed away mere weeks before he was scheduled to hit the stage once again. But what tangled mess did Michael Jackson leave behind? How did the estate's finances prosper post the artist's demise? And was Michael Jackson worth more dead than alive? After news broke of Michael Jackson's sudden passing on June 25, 2009, radio airwaves were filled with his most beloved music as a tribute, to celebrate an artist that truly redefined modern popular music. Having experienced decade-long periods of spiraling debts and career downfalls, Michael Jackson's finances had fallen into complete disarray by the time of his demise. So how did the superstar's shocking death ignite a career resurgence? How many billions has the Michael Jackson estate made since? And ultimately, was Michael Jackson really worth more dead than alive? Here's the detail. As the world mourned, nostalgia for his extensive catalog strengthened and posthumous sales of Michael Jackson skyrocketed up the charts. Billboard reported that distributors quickly ran out of physical CDs, but in the age of digital music, online purchases helped fuel the sudden surge of demand in the wake of his passing. Within 2 weeks, Jackson sold over 800,000 albums, according to Nielsen SoundScan. The artist also sold over 2.7 million digital singles, and if you include the Jackson 5 in Nielsen totals, Jackson was responsible for more than 6.2 million downloads. To put this in context, no single artist had sold more than a million digital tracks in a single week since Nielsen began recording in July 2004. However, despite this huge influx in music sales, Michael Jackson's finances were in complete disarray at the time of his death, and many feared whether there was enough even to pay for the superstar's funeral. When the King of Pop's will was opened, which was last updated in 2002, it named his former attorney John Branca and music executive John McClain as executors of the will and confirms that the Michael Jackson estate should be placed in a private trust. The singer left $33 million to each of his three children, as well as his mother Catherine. They were named as beneficiaries of the estate, both parties being given a 40% share, while the remaining 20% going to unspecified charities that benefited children. Jackson's trust also included a no-contest clause that called for anyone who challenged the will to be disinherited. The executors moved quickly to take control of all of Michael Jackson's property, going to court hours after filing to challenge a previous ruling that gave Catherine Jackson control of 2,000 items from Neverland that were to be sold at auction mere months earlier. Paul Gordon Hoffman, an attorney for the executors, told a Superior Court judge his clients are the proper people to take over Jackson's financial affairs from now on. With an estimated value of more than $500 million, documents stated that Jackson's estate consisted almost entirely of non-cash, non-liquid assets, including primarily an interest in the catalog of music royalty rights which is currently being administered by Sony ATV. While Jackson's portion of Sony ATV was worth an estimated $500 million at the time of his death, he also had about $400 million of debt taken out against it. Despite speculation, Branca said at the time, quote, "We do not contemplate selling any portion of Sony ATV." In the aftermath of the superstar's death, the posthumous business of Michael Jackson was predicted to generate $50 million to $100 million annually. Quote, "We are very optimistic about the revenue we will generate," said Howard Weitzman, an attorney for the estate. Quote, "But we also have to be sober about the debt the estate has." That being said, the estate swiftly got to work, and one of the first things they did was struck up a deal with Sony worth $60 million for the distribution rights on a movie using footage shot during rehearsals for the concerts Jackson was never to perform in London. Titled This Is It, when it debuted in theaters in October 2009, ticket sales for the film broke international records a month before its release, and the film made $261 million worldwide, making it the highest-grossing documentary concert film of all time. This Is It was also the title of the film's accompanying compilation album, which debuted at number one on the US pop charts, selling in its first week 373,000 copies, according to Nielsen SoundScan. The success of This Is It, a massive spike in music sales, a deal to re-release Jackson's 1988 autobiography, and various other merchandising contracts, meant the executors netted almost $100 million in its first few months, with the expectation for another $100 million to roll in by the end of their first 12 months in operation. Quote, "We're approaching the $100 million mark," said Branca. Quote, "Clearly that's a new record for estates that likely will not be broken." Many experts believed that Jackson's estate earnings could eclipse those of another famous and profitable music icon, Elvis Presley. Quote, "Unlike the typical estate, the operation of Michael Jackson's estate is more akin to the operation of a multi-million dollar business enterprise," attorney Gerald S. Cohen commented. Now raking in the cash, those responsible were looking to benefit from their success, with both Branca and McClain in late 2009 filing in court seeking 5% of profits the estate had earned so far. At this point, the administrators and attorneys had not been paid since Jackson's death and for the work they had done resurrecting the pop icon's finances. In March 2010, the estate secured another windfall of cash when they signed with Sony Music a record-breaking $250 million deal for music distribution rights. The blockbuster agreement involved as many as 10 new Jackson projects, including computer video games and music and film releases. Described by Sony and Jackson's estate as the most lucrative music contract on record, the deal would reportedly guarantee the late singer's heirs at least $200 million. By the first anniversary of his death, Billboard.com estimated that projects relating to Michael Jackson had grossed nearly $1 billion, in part because of the new Sony Music record deal and the posthumous documentary, This Is It. Not only in cinema tickets, but the accompanying DVD had earned $43 million in US sales and $23 million in rental revenue. Over the 12-month period, Michael Jackson's catalog earned about $383 million and about $34 million in digital sales, with over 40 million albums sold worldwide, making him by far the highest-selling artist of the year. It was estimated that his estate had earned $250 million thus far. John Branca noting that the other high-earning careers held by dead music legends indicated the value of Jackson's brand. Quote, "If you look at Elvis and the Beatles and how their brands are thriving, they only hint at what the future holds for Michael. This demonstrating that the legacy of Michael Jackson was far more profitable than when the pop performer was alive, far exceeding his earnings at the peak of his profitability in the late 1980s when he was named the highest paid entertainer in the world." In 2010, Forbes named Michael Jackson the highest-earning dead celebrity, with a gross income of $275 million, noting that, quote, "he'd had posthumous number ones, a hit film, and now with his highest album pre-sales ever, Jackson is in pole position to top the Christmas charts. Not bad for a washed-up dead man." The album in question was the posthumous Michael, released in late 2010. The now controversial record in its first 5 weeks sold over 434,000 copies in the United States and went on to sell over 3 million copies. During the 2010 Christmas period, Michael Jackson: The Experience, a video game based on MJ's music, was also released. It was developed and published by Ubisoft for Nintendo DS, PlayStation Portable, and Wii, and sold 2 million units in 2 months, making it one of Wii's best-selling games. However, despite the Michael Jackson estate having generated over $310 million in revenue by 2011, according to court papers filed, administrators were still grappling with the enormous amounts of debt Jackson left behind. His estate at that point had used $159 million to pay down the pop star's debt, which when Jackson died, amounted to more than $400 million, as court records showed. Quote, "Although there remains unresolved creditor claims, pending litigation, and additional challenging business, tax, and legal issues, the executors have made substantial progress in reducing the estate's debt," the document claimed. The Michael Jackson estate also had issues with the Jackson family, who disapproved with how they were managing their family member's prized legacy and disputed their lack of say in decisions being made. Despite this, the beneficiaries of the estate, that included his mother and children, received more than $9 million in payments since Jackson's death. The estate paid Jackson's mother $70,000 a month in child support for his three children, settled the rent on their mansion in Calabasas, and also picked up the bills for other expenses, which included renovations on the Jackson family home in Encino, Los Angeles. The following year, the estate registered 2012 profits that upped Jackson's total earnings to $475 million since the superstar's death, with over $165 million of that sum made in the last year. At this point, many of his major debts had either been resolved or were no longer delinquent. Branca stated that the singer's personal debt of $200 million had been paid off, and another $300 million tied to his ownership of the Sony and ATV catalogs had been renegotiated. Quote, "Michael had a will and a trust, and that's what we follow," he said. They also announced an agreement with Sony ATV Music Publishing to administer Jackson's MyJack music catalog. The deal was expected to generate enough revenue to pay off a remaining $5 million loan by the end of 2012. That same year, the 25th anniversary deluxe edition of Michael Jackson's 1987 Bad album was released, as well as the accompanying documentary directed by Spike Lee, Bad 25, to great acclaim. The state also had great success with Michael Jackson The Immortal World Tour, a Cirque du Soleil tribute show based on Jackson's music. The arena show began touring in October 2011 and finished in February 2014, totaling 501 shows in 141 cities. Just 2 months after it was launched, the show had sold over $100 million in ticket sales. Eventually, the tour amassed $371 million in revenue, making it the most financially successful Cirque production ever, the highest-grossing tribute show in history, and the eighth-highest-grossing tour of all time. In 2013, Forbes estimated that the estate had made over $145 million in the last year through a range of music and merchandising deals, as well as another collaboration with Cirque du Soleil that resulted in an elaborate new residency. Michael Jackson won in Las Vegas. The magazine also confirmed that the estate had earned at least $600 million since 2009. Time is an elixir, said Stephen G. Hill, the president of music programming and specials at BET Networks. Quote, "We've already seen in 4 years that what is really celebrated about him is his music and his place among the greatest entertainers of all time." By this point, the Michael Jackson estate had effectively eliminated the colossal debts the superstar left behind, and they were now a fully solvent entity. In 2014, the year would be marked by the release of the estate's second posthumous album, Escape. The album charted higher than Michael, going to number one in its first week of release in worldwide sales, selling upwards of 1 million copies. The record was preceded by the release of its lead single, Love Never Felt So Good, which included a newly recorded version that featured Justin Timberlake. Reaching a Billboard Hot 100 chart position of number 9, the track gave Michael Jackson his first top 10 hit since 2001's You Rock My World. To promote the new record, the estate employed cutting-edge technology company Hologram USA Inc. to bring Michael's magic back to life one more time for the 2014 Billboard Awards, debuting a controversial Michael Jackson hologram, performing the track Slave to the Rhythm at the star-studded ceremony. By the fifth anniversary of the artist's death, Jackson's star power was brighter than it had been in decades thanks to John Branca and John McClane, who had pocketed more than $17 million between them for their work with the estate. By the end of 2014, Forbes had Michael Jackson, once again, in the number one position in their list of top-earning dead celebrities, reporting annual earnings of $140 million. In 2015, Michael Jackson yet again was in top position with an income of $115 million from the previous 12 months. In May 2015, it was announced that the Neverland Ranch, renamed Sycamore Valley Ranch, would be put up for sale with an initial price tag of $100 million. After years of speculation that the ranch, one of the most famous private residences in the world, would be open for the public as a Graceland-style attraction. The property that once served as Jackson's home and personal fantasy land was finally listed for sale after years in limbo since his death. Jointly owned by the Jackson Estate and Colony North Star, according to Time, the owners were seeking a buyer who did not plan to turn the ranch into a Jackson museum. However, due to lack of interest, the asking price at the ranch was dropped to $67 million by February 2017 and then dropped once again in February 2019 to $31 million. Before December 2020, when billionaire Ron Burkle, a former family friend of Jackson, purchased the property at a rock-bottom price of $22 million as a, quote, land banking opportunity. However, despite Neverland turning out to be one of the superstar's less astute investments, in 2016 his estate collected a colossal windfall of cash from the sale of his most prized asset, Sony ATV Music Publishing. Valued at an estimated $1.5 billion, Michael Jackson's 50% share of Sony/ATV was making an annual income of around $80 million, with the most popular Beatles songs generating between $300,000 to $400,000 each. In September 2016, a deal was finalized for Sony's acquisition of Jackson's share of Sony/ATV from the Jackson estate for $750 million, 16 times what Jackson paid for the music catalog back in 1985. As a result, by the end of 2016, Jackson's estate had earned a whopping $825 million, the highest yearly amount for a celebrity ever recorded by Forbes. The following year, Forbes reported earnings of $75 million, but these sky-high payouts kept coming thanks to Jackson's music investments. When in July 2018, the now Sony Music-owned and operated Sony/ATV bought out the Jackson estate's 10% stake in Emmy Music for an incredible $287.5 million. This deal, primarily contributing to the Michael Jackson estate's impressive annual earnings of $400 million for the year of 2018. It was the eighth year since his death that Jackson's annual earnings were reported to be over $100 million, thus bringing Jackson's post-mortem profits total to $2.4 billion. In 2020, Forbes recognized Jackson as the top-earning dead celebrity every year since his death, except 2012, after his dear friend Elizabeth Taylor's estate auctioned off her legendary jewelry collection, bringing in her annual earnings for the year to $210 million. In the years since, the Michael Jackson estate has continued to be one of the most profitable and powerful in the entertainment industry, regularly topping the list of top-earning dead celebrities despite having sold off his most profitable assets. In many ways, the incredible turnaround of Michael Jackson's career and profitability post his passing, despite continued speculation and controversies, has acted as a blueprint for many savvy artists alive today, giving them an insight into how their legacy in the world of entertainment could and should be managed post their inevitable demise. In the words of co-executor John Branca, quote, "In the early days of rock and roll, companies owned everything and fought with the artists' representatives to gain control of their IP. Now it's swung back in the other direction as artists get older and are estate planning and tax planning and selling their IP back to the companies. It's come full circle." Thanks for watching The Detail. Let us know in the comments if you believe the Michael Jackson estate has been as much of a success as their bank balance would suggest, and follow for more in-depth Michael Jackson investigations. We'll see you next time.